It's a dominant idea in policy practices across the world that the nation state is the center of political power and authority. Today, this idea is challenged by cities and scholars alike, who argue that cities are more effective and powerful when it comes to solving today's sustainability challenges. Most states have a three-level system consisting of a national government, provinces or districts, and municipalities. Through hierarchical mechanisms, the power of the lower level governments is restricted by the higher level. According to this rationale, cities are the lowest and thus least powerful level. But many cities claim the opposite. They say that cities are the first and most important level, as it is at their level that citizens have face-to-face contacts with politicians and civil servants, that governors know their people and their problems, and that there is real feedback between policies and its positive and negative, expected and unexpected effects. What's more, cities feel that they don't have the luxury of waiting for the national governments or UN summits to solve challenging problems such as climate change, environmental pollution, or food shortages. They start solving these problems in rather successful ways, and national governments cannot stop them from doing so. For example, the moment that President Donald Trump announced that the United States would withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreements, big cities in the USA immediately criticized and ignored this decision. The mayor of Austin, for example, sent the following tweet: "Austin will not stop fighting climate change. Worldwide, cities will lead in achieving climate treaty goals because so much of what's required happens at the local level." I just explained to you the position of cities. Now I will talk about the groundbreaking book entitled If Mayors Ruled the World. In this book, Benjamin Barber argues that cities are much better than nations in solving today's sustainability challenges. He has three arguments, which I will address successfully. Firstly, Barber argues that cities are more effective when compared to nation states because they are less ideological. This is nicely illustrated by the famous words of former New York mayor Fiorello La Guardia. He said, "There is no democratic or republican way of fixing a sewer." Whereas national governments pay a lot of attention to developing plans and organizing implementation structures, cities have to solve urgent and practical problems. They do not have a lower level to implement their decisions, and they can't blame others. Secondly, cities are more willing to collaborate with other parties in their cities, such as private companies, NGOs, or citizen groups. Most cities are very well aware of so-called interdependencies in today's network society. They know that they can't solve sustainability problems alone. However, innovative collaborations and so-called public-private partnerships are also vulnerable to less transparent and less inclusive agreements. Finally, Barber argues that cities behave more democratically than nation states. First of all, they are closer to citizens. Cities are the places where people meet in the street, and even in megacities such as Amsterdam or Kampala, most citizens know their mayor. Cities are often able to find solutions even when citizens' views and backgrounds are fundamentally different. Most examples of citizen participations and forms of co-creation between governments and citizens are located in cities, and that is telling for how they get along. However, not all cities are willing to listen to their citizens, and we all know of city governments who mainly protect the interest of a powerful elite. Although cities may be capable of innovative democratic practices, not all of them behave accordingly. These three arguments of Barber are convincing, but we must not forget that the role of cities largely depends on state traditions and historically grown institutions. For example, the role assigned to citizens is different in Beijing when compared to Amsterdam or Kampala. In Beijing, the history of the one-party system influences the role of city authorities and their relationship to local citizens. In the informal settlements of Kampala, local citizens blame their authorities for not being able or willing to fix their sewers in the first place, but they also organize themselves in NGOs and try to develop policy strategies for sustainability. In Amsterdam, citizens are actively encouraged by city-financed institutes, such as Waag Society, to actively engage in bottom-up city politics for sustainability. To summarize, cities can be very powerful in creating and co-creating sustainability transitions in their cities. But administrative traditions and political context always matter.